welcome to the writing room. This is the 14th program, and we'll be working with one of the most important lessons of all, and this is the one concerning rhythm. You remember in the first program, I quoted the Roman poet Horace to the effect that spoken words fly and written words remain. Now, he was praising writing in that statement, but there's something rather sad about the fact that the spoken word flies. It's intensely alive, even though it vanishes the moment that we hear it, as a bird would vanish from sight. It's a living, rich experience to hear good speech, but the writing can be dead. And much printing, I think, is likely to strike us as being objective, out there, unable to move, quite dead. I think this is reflected unintentionally and rather unfortunately in the word layout, which we use in regard to design. I hate that word. Corpses are laid out, and it sounds as if the words and the letter forms were dead and were slicked up for everyone to look at before they're put away. What can give writing some of the vitality, some of the life, the exquisite reality of spoken words? I'd say that the rhythm, the secret's in the rhythm, in the touch and the movement going ahead rhythmically. And if we work rhythmically, we'll find that our work is easier. All over the world before the Industrial Revolution, most work was done rhythmically. And you're familiar with work songs, at least you've heard about them, about the slaves in the South having work songs as they hoed cotton, or as they picked cotton, or they're working in longshore work. We know about the song of the Volga boatman in Russia. Work was done rhythmically and usually with singing. But in the factory, with this machinery, and with the various kinds of inhuman work that a person must go through in a factory, the music's impossible. The rhythm is impossible. Everything becomes far too mechanical. Now, the Chinese have a marvelous saying about calligraphy, and I wish it could apply to our own, that when you look at a piece of Chinese calligraphy, the brush starts moving all over again. Of course, this is possible if one is trained in Chinese calligraphy and knows the traditional order and direction of stroke. And he can see the amount of pressure on the brush. He can see the speed with which the brush moved. And as he looks at it, he sees the activity that went into writing that, and the Oriental calligraphy has a vitality of movement which we're likely to find missing in typography. Now, the old printing types were produced by a sculptural sort of process. The punch cutter, who later cut out the forms of the letters with engraving tools, chisels with files and so on, was moving, and his movement actually created a gesture in the form of that letter. But it's much harder to see that movement in printing types, although I think that one who is familiar with typography, familiar with the history of the calligraphy of early periods, can see even in what might seem the most mechanical looking typography that there is gesture there. There is a kind of movement, but it lacks the vitality and the free movement which any handwriting is bound to have. The gesture of the handwriting becomes in time a personal kind of gesture, a personal rhythm. And even though the writing may be somewhat illegible, the rhythm of that person's way of moving is bound to be seen. And you can recognize him by his rhythm. And as I said before, it's as personal as the rhythm of his own walking. So after a while, after you put the letter into your hand, so that the hand can move without self-consciousness, without this twiddling black-robed judge inside the head interfering and complaining all the time about things, the hand can go ahead and move with some sort of rhythm. The rhythm may be pleasing, it may be jerky, it may look erratic, and it often reflects the emotional state that the writer is in when he is writing. That's one reason that we would calm ourselves before we try to do any important scribal work. You sit, you may go through various forms of meditation. Some people use practice, various aspects of yoga. The Chinese traditionally would grind their ink. Now the ink sticks would be very old, very hard, and it might take 20 minutes to half an hour to sit quietly and rotate that heavy ink stick on the ink slab. And the rhythm of the circular movement of that ink stick as one grinds his ink before writing becomes, in 20 minutes, a calming experience, because one must be relaxed in order to let the letter or the character come out of the writing tool. And remember, we shouldn't at least ever be caught making our hand writing a particular letter form. We have to let it write the letter form, because the letting is the important thing. Now in the text here, at the beginning of the lesson, as you read it, you see that I recommend that most of your effort be placed on the part that is on the lower part of the page. There's rhythm there, although it's not the free sort of dancing rhythm that's above. It's not in any sense a metronomic rhythm. But let's do some writing and see about the rhythm of it. In the next program, the one following this, we'll work with the Mozart, which is mentioned in this. It takes two programs to cover this one in the 17th plate. But let's see something of what the movement might be like with this rather functional, plain, modernized italic of Alfred Fairbanks that we see in the lower half of the page. And I recommend that you use your medium nib with fine guidelines. First word is mythology. Go rather rapidly on the hairline, slower on the downstroke. A little less pressure on the hairlines than on the downstroke. This is a rhythmical series of movements. I hope your hand is moving as you watch this. Pretend, as I've said repeatedly, that the hand you see on the television screen is your own hand. Try to identify with it and imagine that this hand is on your wrist. So move your hand with it. Try to anticipate what the touch and the movement is going to be, so that you get some experience of the rhythm. And it can be a very relaxing, very calming experience. I had nervous wrecks in my class after World War II and after Korea. Boys at Reed who had been in hospitals, and they claimed that the work in the graphic arts workshop with calligraphy helped them as almost nothing else had. And they, at home, they might get up in the middle of the night and write to calm themselves if they found the memories of the battlefields were more than they could take. And I think it had the calming effect because they could get into the beautiful rhythm and the stance of the pen. It will have a more calming and rhythmical effect if you don't let your thoughts enter into it at all, but just experience the sensation of touch and movement and watch this wonderful edge producing these graphic symbols. The edge of the pen is the outer activity. The image of movement and touch of movement is the inward activity. In that wonderful quotation, which I am so fond of, consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. They toil not. Now, you may say, well, how can we produce things without toil? We're supposed to be working with the sweat of our brow. Well, that's one way of looking at it, and some work requires the sweat of the brow and some toil. But I think that much of the work, of the physical work which we do, can be done with a sort of impersonal objectivity, as if we were innocent bystanders watching the thing going on, and we seem in one way not to be involved, in another way we're more involved than we ever have been in anything before in our lives, because we are all awareness, and the movement of that edge and the sensations of the movement of our hand become the whole universe. They fill the Milky Way, they fill the whole cosmos, our awareness of that touch and the movement. And when one can become lost in that kind of impersonal awareness, he really becomes what is behind, I think, the person that we are. He becomes something quite superior. He's more aware, he feels more capable, more competent, and people have had what they call peak experiences with this sort of activity. This is what it means to be lost in the work. And when you're lost in the work, it's not toil. In a way, it is as natural, I'd say, as the budding and the blooming of the lily in the field. But it requires no crunching kind of effort. When we are fighting inside ourselves to try to do something or other, when our mind is in there twiddling, unable to make up its judgment as to what we should be doing, then there is toil, then it is most painful. But even heavy manual labor, pick and shovel work, the falling of huge trees, when done rhythmically and when done with skill, becomes an activity that seems to be carried on almost by something else. And then I say that we're working very much the way plants would be working in growing. It isn't toil in the usual sense. And I think that's what the quotation means, by toiling not. We become part of a flow, part of the flow of the rhythm of the universe, which has been in Eastern thought is thought of as a dance. And even in Havelock Ellis, there's a book called The Dance of Life. And dance is not toil. Dance is an expression of joy, and it's an involvement in movement, because everything is movement. Well, let's look at some writing again. The flower grows naturally. Writing is not a natural activity. It's a human and artificial activity. I'm not sure that I like that distinction. It sounds somewhat artificial to me. It's natural for human beings to make things. And if it's natural for us to make things, I say it can be very natural for us to want to write down the symbols of our speech. And the way so many people get joy out of it, out of producing it, and out of seeing it, and reading the writing, would make it certainly natural to human nature. So, and we're part of the universe. Every atom in our body is as old as the sun. The moon is our sister, as far as age is concerned. These atoms are ancient, we're part of the whole works. And human nature is part of a natural evolution. And it's human nature to make things with your hands. Because as I said before, I'm quoting Robinson Jeffers, we too are human. We have hands, not paws. So I talk and I lose my spelling. I'll show you later how to avoid making spelling mistakes. But you can't talk about something a little different and be sure your spelling's going to be right. Graphy. The Greek word graphos could be used for writing or for drawing. Wonderful graphic organization in New York City, which has members all over the United States. People involved in the printing industry who are letter artists, who are designers of printed pieces, book designers and whatnot, they call themselves the typophiles. They print some beautiful things. I'm a member of the typophile organization and love the point of view of these people, these men and women, and the kind of work they turn out, because their work is a joy. It's not just an inhuman toil. Now, let's take some words that involve more of the kind of movement you might use in a display line, in a quotation that has just a few words, a few lines in it. The one with the push heads. When two L's come together, the first one will be shorter, second one will fall higher. I've had students tell me that they hear music inside their heads when they're writing, but that's after they've been having exercises with music in my classes. Whoa, the spelling again, the calligraphy, there is such a thing, I suppose. One of the beautiful words in English language, it's a much nicer word, I'd say, than layout. This sounds more like something alive. One of the nicest things in the New Testament, I think, is Easter morning when Mary Magdalene mistakes the risen Christ for the gardener. He doesn't look like some roisterer coming home from a night in the tavern. She doesn't think he's one of the plainclothes policemen of Herod's. There's something about him that is different. He's concerned with growing, living things, those things that are natural. The man concerned with making the lily in the field prosper. She mistook him for the gardener. Now, the two F's come together, we can get a nice rhythmical effect. We haven't had this combination before. You can come down and then angle that. It makes a nice contrast. I'm using a rather larger pen than the one I recommend for you because this looks better on the television screen. That F is short, you see, and it can touch the longer L. Variations in speed help build up a rhythmical sequence. We'll call this the end of the line. Whoops, come up first like that. Fascinating word, the word style. Its origin is the metal stylus which the Roman used in scratching his letters on wax, on the wax tablet, which means a little table, a little rectangle with black wax. And style comes from that writing tool. So the poet had a great style. He's had a great pen. The style is concerned with writing in its original meaning. Rhythm. Now this, we don't use this very much today. It's one of the Renaissance ties. You see it in some old style typography, but isolate that white paper in here. It makes a very beautiful shape, a very beautiful pattern. And when you're writing, as I say, watch the ink, watch the white paper. And one way you can do both, in a sense, is to concentrate on the edges of the S, the edge of this stroke up here, the horizontal, the edge of the downstroke on the T. By concentrating on the edges, and letting your eye flow through in the movement with which it was written, you can get a sense of the total design of the word. The word has to be a living design. One of the lovely words for rhythmical discoveries is this flight. Dance that. Dance that word over and over again. In the Renaissance, it was customary to make F generally a short letter, not going clear up to the crescendo line. And the L and G are a little too close together. But let it fly.